as promised, this series is about a variety of practices, and it's really about thinking about why and how practice matters. Tonight we're joined by Peter Tonkin, who I can now proudly call Dr. Peter Tonkin, which I'll explain in a second. Peter went to one of those other schools, Sydney University, for his first class honours degree in architecture. And then he wised up a bit not so long ago and went to RMIT University and did his PhD, which was through the practice-based research stream. And like I said, he's now Dr. Peter Tonkin. I know Peter through this endeavour. I was one of his supervisors, but I also know him through his work in Tonkin Zulaikha Greer, which we'll speak about today, in particular the National Arboretum in Canberra. So Peter's probably going to talk a lot about design tonight, but how he sees it and what he discovered, I suspect, through doing a PhD, very arduously looking at his practice, and how someone who's been in practice and built a number of fantastic built works starts to interrogate those things and maybe see them differently when they're doing it through a PhD lens. He's done a number of complex buildings, from, you know, brand new buildings to lots of adaptive reuse, which in Newcastle we really, you know, love adaptive reuse here. The firm Tonkin Zulaikha Greer and his team have won a number of awards. I would expect in not such a distant future to maybe add Peter to a few people wearing a bit of gold. Just to acknowledge that he's also been a big player in terms of giving lectures. He's very generous with his time. He's an adjunct professor at the University of Queensland and the University of Canberra as well. And we're quite honoured to have you here tonight, Peter.
SueAnne asked me to focus particularly on adaptive reuse, and so I did. It's been a kind of thread through our practice since the early 1990s, and you'll see that early 1990s project in a while. And in a sense, this is a bit of a how TZG go about adaptive reuse projects. So it's kind of a little primer, a manual of how to go about things. The photo there is really one of our very current projects. It's a collection of early to mid 19th century buildings which are being turned into a public school with not quite enough time or money. And the degree of difficulty, I think, is up at number 10. But I picked this picture because most people look at adaptive reuse and old buildings and all they see is the crap and the difficulty involved in it. And it's always been, I think, a really good kind of challenge for our practice and something that we find very creative in bringing up to contemporary code standards on the one hand, but also functional standards on the other, a whole series of interesting buildings which might otherwise progress further into the bird poo land of decay. So underpinning adaptive reuse is this notion of significance, which, if the building happens to be heritage listed, becomes something that's teased out by a heritage consultant. And the sketch behind that is by a lovely and incredibly talented University of Newcastle graduate called Matilda Watson, who works in our office, and was the kind of ideogram for one of our current projects that I won't be talking about, which is the conservation of the Bondi Pavilion. But when we talk about significance, you start to do drawings like this, where you put the plan, and this is the pavilion, and you colour it in according to how significant the various spaces are according to the conservation management plan. And it gives you a really good background and underpinning for the bits that you can play fast and loose with and the bits that you have to be very, very careful with. And I won't kind of dwell on that, but I presented this project to a very rowdy public forum on Monday night, It's very dear to the hearts of the residents, and drawings like this become incredibly important in facing the community because they're worried that their lovely building will get destroyed by greedy architects and greedy councils. And if you can start to use a firm and factual background, it makes life much easier. So the first thing that we really look at when you're adapting an old building is, does the new use fit with the old building? And if it doesn't, life becomes much more difficult. And very often we've found that where it doesn't fit well, the project just dies anyway, because the cost and the degree of difficulty in getting it through all the planning application stages just makes it simply impossible. So in each of these little themes, I'm going to talk about one project. This is a mid to late 19th century Baptist church in the middle of Darlinghurst, the Burton Street Tabernacle, incredibly handsome building, which, because of the kind of declining level of the congregation in the 60s, 70s and 80s in Darlinghurst, people stopped going to church, really. It fell into complete disrepair. It was bought by Sydney City Council with no very firm idea of what they wanted to do with it. They conserved the lovely wooden ceiling, just really as, I think, a badge of honour. But the interior stayed a crumbling mess, and I won't go through a whole heap of photos about how awful it was, but particularly the floor under this church auditorium was pretty horrible. And our brief was to turn it into a 200 seat, and it had to be 200 seat because that was a major commercial cut-off, 200 seat drama theatre for a very small but incredibly successful inner city theatre company. And our client was the city council, but the user was this Darlinghurst theatre company. And essentially we thought this was a good fit because the drama theatre fitted into, although only just, the space that was the church. And the space that was the church was the space that had the highest significance. So we were able to conserve that space and demolish the whole wing at the back to fit in four stories of dressing rooms and backstage and offices and plant, and then rework the very rotting Sunday school that had been under the church with no daylight into the foyer and bath and a little cafe, so that the fit was good. The only major bit of fabric we had to get rid of was half the floor of the church to get the steeper rake that the drama theatre required. And it was a very difficult project in that the tiny bit of space out the back had footings of early 18th century terrace houses that had to be excavated professionally. And under the exedra that you can see there was a baptismal font, which was like a spa bath that you walked into and got baptised. And that was held up in space while the excavation went on. You can see the steel whalers there and get a sense of how hard it was. I'm sorry, that's a crap photo. It looked all right on the screen. So the, you know, level of demolition inside was reasonable, removing the floor underneath, keeping parts of the existing floor, keeping all of the original cast iron structure, and all of the walls and ceiling of the original auditorium, conserving the outside very carefully, putting layer upon layer of very thick glass on the stained glass windows to control noise breakout. It became a very difficult exercise. The new entrance, which opens to the north, then brings light down into what had been this very dark Sunday school. And it becomes this theatre of movement in itself. The journey into the spaces upstairs, the different spaces, the reuse of the floor of the church as the ceiling of that new bar space, and the conserved cast iron structure, And one of the great joys of going to the theatre is, of course, watching all the other people. And this becomes a place where watching other people is really enhanced. Whereas the auditorium itself was treated very, very simply. We pioneered the use of this tensile steel grid instead of a conventional system of catwalks, so that the impact on the ceiling would be minimised. But it had to function as a theatre with all of the kind of services that that entails. We're very happy with this job, completed about a year and a half ago. Has great sight lines, excellent acoustics, and I think is a really good fit with what had been a building that had found no use at all. The next one we'll look at is called Fabric, and this is kind of underpins conservation planning back to a thing called the Borough Charter from the late 1980s, early 1990s, which codified principles about how you might approach a heritage building. And so Fabric, which is the bits of the original building that survive, no matter what they are, becomes the guiding principle for the building itself. And to talk about this, I'm going to talk about the Paddington Reservoir. And this was a 1870s water reservoir that only lasted as a water reservoir for 20 years because it was never high enough to gravity feed the water to the suburb. And in the early 20th century, it became a parking garage with these timber columns, a fake galvanised iron roof under the vault to keep the water out. And in about 1985, bits of it started collapsing. And the park on top was closed. And for the next nearly 30 years, it just kept on collapsing there in the middle of Paddington, walled off from the surrounds, enveloped by, you know, very, very expensive real estate. And finally, the city council bit the bullet and thought, well, we have to do something with this. And our brief, I'd have to say this was entirely done by my partner, Tim Greer, not by me at all, so I can praise it to the skies without being immodest. The brief from council was to cap it, to rebuild the flat, boring lawn on top. And Tim challenged that without support of the whole office, because we loved the sense of it being a ruin, the sense of that the original Fabric had of talking about history in a way that capping it off would never have done. And there's something eloquent about ruins. They charge your imagination. They invoke old notions of time and death and progress in a way that even a beautifully restored building never can. And so we thought we would try and conserve and stabilise as much of this very, very dangerous, collapsing, ruinous fabric as we could. And Tim came up with this concept of preserving the bit that was relatively intact with its flat park on top and doing a sunken park below street level in the other half. And of course it was an extremely challenging exercise to convince a public body that doing an underground park would not be a scene of, you know, violence and disruption. But in fact it's worked perfectly. We worked with Anton James of JMD, another RMIT doctor, who does these, I think, incredibly beautiful drawings. And I've been a bit inspired by those shots that Sasha showed of your foundation, and I wish I'd put some more of my drawings in, but anyway, I didn't. To work out this sunken oasis that would be sheltered from the noise and bustle of Oxford Street and become a place of respite, active enough that it wouldn't in itself be dangerous. And we cast concrete on top of the brick and cast iron vaults, replaced every single one of the hardwood columns with new hardwood columns that were fortunately found in a stockpile in Kempsey. We had enough wood to do that. And started to do this thing which preserved absolutely the maximum of the original fabric, maintained that sense of being a ruin, but created a space of a park which had verandas and loggias and canopies and lawns, so a whole variety of different spaces, all down under street level, and which I think has become a very loved part of Paddington, and yet preserves that sense of ruin. And the bit that was less ruined, which is the so-called Eastern Chamber, has become a kind of party and event space for art installations, fashion parades, all that kind of thing. And we're still struggling with the notion of getting equitable access into that half of the park, but the other half is fully DDA compliant. Next one I'd like to talk about is spaces, because it's very easy to look at the outside of heritage buildings and in the way that the Burton Street Tabernacle Eternity Playhouse did to restore them, in inverted commas, but often you lose sight of the interiors of the buildings and the magic that some of those heritage spaces have. And here I'd like to look at another job of Tim's, again one that I had a bit more to do with than Paddington, but still not very much, which was a 1880s carriage building workshop in Redfern, just west of the city. Had been vacant again for 10 or 15 years and was leased by the New South Wales Ministry for the Arts as a contemporary performing arts centre. And we had a brief to fit 3 theatres and 4 rehearsal rooms and some office space into this half of this vast building. They've only just now, I think, seeking funding to do the other half. And it was a very robust and simple building with repeated pitched roofs with roof-light monitors, a very handsome brick facade, a very nice cast iron detailed interior, bay after bay of repeated columns with railway lines going across the major grid, so that you started a carriage at one end and you pushed it through the building. So it started off at the carpenter's workshop at one end and wound up in the paint shop at the far end and the upholstery shop. And one of the things that was magic about this building was its grand and beautiful structure, which of course once had been full of stuff. But when we came upon it, it was this amazing sense of dramatic and awe-inspiring emptiness. And so when we fitted, you can see the half of the building that was done and the other half that wasn't. When we fitted the theatres and rehearsal rooms in, there was quite a lot of leftover space. And the pale blue bit, we made a very, very large foyer, which was, I think, 7 times the briefed size of the foyer. The Minister of the Arts said, well, we don't need a foyer that big, fill it up with something. We said, well, what are we going to fill it up with? There's nothing in the brief. And fortunately, we managed to keep it this great big empty space where you could look from one end of the building to the other and get some sense of its original scale and vastness. And as a kind of interesting corollary, that's an elevation of the back wall of the foyer with the very tall roof there of the middle coloured orange, the 600 seat large theatre, which had to have a very high ceiling space because it's used for aerial circus. It's interesting that the carriage works earns more money from the foyer than they do from the rest of the building put together, because it's a loose fit, robust space that you can do anything in. So they have ice skating rinks, fashion week, parties, book launches, all sorts of things in that foyer. And because it's so big, you can actually have things on there at the same time as people are going to a show in one of the theatres. It was sunken down below the road, and Tim very cleverly took all the trusses that we had to take out of the roof to build the tall performance space and made a kind of entry sculpture which signals the building from the street. The foyer becomes this cross space across the various bays. And between each of the theatres you can look down between those beautiful paired cast iron columns, again the length of the building, so that you get a sense of its entire entire volume. And that you get a sense of how the carriage work starts to use it, how the individual parts have been very, very straightforwardly detailed in a contemporary kind of way to clean, simple surfaces that start to resonate very nicely with the richness of the patina and then the enclosed spaces of the theatres themselves. So I might go back to that, it was a bit quick. A lot of effort here again with noise breakout because of angry local residents. The next one I'd like to talk about was something that kind of featured large in my PhD analysis, and this is a really very personal way that I and the firm approach heritage buildings. And I called it layers because it seems to encapsulate how these things are designed. And it all went back to our first project, which was the Hyde Park Barracks in Sydney from the early 1990s, where we were commissioned to refit the interior of the building. The exterior had been conserved by other people as a museum that explained and celebrated the building itself. Rather than being a museum of something else, it was a museum of Hyde Park Barracks related particularly to convictism. And a building is from 1817, it's World Heritage listed, incredibly significant. Every little bit of the original Francis Greenway fabric was, in our words, sacred. So that the Greenway fabric became a given layer. But on top of that, we had to put this layer of what I called machinery for a museum. So air conditioning, lighting, showcases, handrails, signage, all that kind of stuff, light control. And we made the decision at this design competition stage that that would read as a consistent and coherent layer that was as different as possible to the brick and timber of the Hyde Park Barracks. And we did it out of steel and glass so that it would be as different as possible and start to tie together all of that layer of machinery in a way that would make it clear to people who visited the museum what was old and what was new. But kind of added to that was the fact that the building itself had layers. The bottom floor had been very seriously reworked in the early 1980s, and much of the original Greenway stuff was either covered up or removed. The middle layer had been reworked in the Victorian period when the building was a law courts. And it was decided that the top floor would be restored in the conventional sense back to Francis Greenway when Clive Lucas really did most of that work. So the building itself becomes layers, and as well we get the layers of Francis Greenway, the layers of Victorian architecture, the layers of 1980s intervention, and then our layer of steel and glass. So that there's the Greenway layer on the roof, where our intervention is as modest as a cable tray and a few lights, and for the rest of it, the old building speaks of its history, deliberately kept very empty so that somehow the ghosts can talk to you. The hammocks that were recreated from tiny bits found within the floor cavities. The showcases, these were christened by us the Farnsworth cases, because they looked like the Farnsworth house, and how we lit them underneath so that they floated above the old floors. And around the walls, the Victorian colour schemes were recreated. The ceilings, which we stripped off plasterboard, where there was Greenway paint, it just stayed there. Where there had been modern replacements, where we painted the new bits white to match the Greenway, so that you can read very clearly the age of each bit of those fabric according to what layer it is. And in the front room, the layering was quite dramatic and overt because we actually stripped back literally the layers of plaster and brickwork on the walls so that you could see how it had been altered as the 40 different government uses took it over. And that showcase becomes a layer cake in itself, with the convict stuff at the bottom, the female immigration depot, and then the law courts in layers above. Second last one, so you could bear with me. Actually, this might be the last one. So the last one is something that I've been very aware of as an architect, and it is not specifically related to heritage buildings, but only to buildings in general, and that's the sense of a journey through the building, what Corb called the promenade architecturale. So the way you might orchestrate and modulate the spaces and levels and views and sound and light within a building so that the experience of moving through that building is delightful on the one hand, but also comprehensible on the other. And I think you've all been aware of buildings like hospitals where the corridors are have a high degree of sameness and very similar lighting, and you just get lost. Whereas celebrating that journey and making the maximum amount, if I can say that, of differentiation and the maximum amount of delight in the way you might move through that building, I think becomes one of the underpinning parts of our architecture. And we were lucky enough about 3 years ago to get a job where really the sole purpose of our work was to create a journey through a heritage building, apart, of course, from conserving the original fabric. And this was a town hall in Glebe in the inner city. Originally was a municipality in its own right, was subsumed by Leichhardt Municipality, who basically got six of these heritage town halls and hated having all of them and did nothing to them at all. And then when the city council got Glebe in one of those kind of political gerrymanders, they actually had some money to spend on the building. And it's very interesting that the use of the building didn't change at all. It was a sequence of public things like childcare, guidance, baby health, a one-stop shop for council, and then four very large halls for hire. That's what it was in the Victorian period. That's what it is currently. So our work was to conserve the exterior and to sort out the kind of extremely convoluted and difficult circulation route through the building, which not only didn't comply with any kind of code, but limited the occupancy of the building because of the lack of fire escape and the lack of disabled access. Very handsome fabric, kind of basically most of it was in reasonable condition apart from a lot of the cedar joinery which had been painted. But out the back, sorry about this photo, but you can't kind of, was too close to get a decent one, was this amazing jumble of little additions. So toilets up on steel posts, a fantastic mad veranda that went nowhere. And our approach, you can see there the history of the building, the dark pink was the original building. Then about 15 years later, the same architects added the orange bit. And the two of them didn't basically communicate at all. They each had their own staircase, their own front entrance, and to get from one to the other was virtually impossible. So we looked at that quadrangle of a courtyard on the south of the building and thought we'll make a glass-filled atrium in that space that would unite the fire egress, the lift, and puncture through the original building to create direct foyer space for the three halls that made up the building as a whole. And I mean, this is one of those drawings that I did with no kind of intention of it ever being published, but it kind of, because this job was very fast, we never got a chance to do better ones. This was a slightly better, more considered drawing, but in fact I think so much worse piece of graphics. But anyway, there you can see the ground floor with one of the halls, number 13, the new glass atrium which had a kind of tree up the middle, a lift shaft which was structural, from which the roof cantilevered and from which we hung the glass facades, so that new piece didn't in fact engage with or touch the original building at all. It couldn't be completely removed and you get back to the original town hall. Up above were two more halls, including number 22, this incredibly grand and beautiful 1870s room, which had been built as the ballroom for Glebe and which effectively became a ballroom again, finally with enough toilets and a catering kitchen so that and some soundproofing so that it can be used in a contemporary kind of way. There's the back of the building with the new glass atrium with a kind of frit all over the glass, partly to veil the view from inside of the house next door, and partly to kind of bring that sense of leafy, broken light that we liked from that courtyard back into the building, whereas I think just plain glass would have been very a bit too brutal. We also liked the way that the patterning on that glass starts to talk to some of the fine detail within the original building and break down the scale of what is basically a very kind of contemporary addition. So from that original first half of the building, we knocked a hole in the wall, which was the biggest piece of significant fabric we removed, so that you can walk from the old front door into our new atrium and get some daylight coming through the space. And then you come into this atrium with its door onto the new garden in the south, the large staircase going up, and the tree of the lift shaft. And we clad that all in this very rich pattern of different coloured timbers as a kind of nod to the original building, which had had this striped tongue and groove boarding in cedar and pine, much of which had been painted and which we stripped. And we really liked the kind of vibrancy of that different timber and started to recreate it in a contemporary way in the cladding of that lift shaft and then growing up as the tree into the ceiling. The walls of the original building around it had the lead-based paint stripped off and left purely in their kind of stripped fashion. We conserved the little veranda, which becomes an access route into one of the halls. And looking up from the basement, where we get bicycle parking and a whole lot of other facilities, and is linked through, you get a real, I think, sense of how delightful that journey up the stairs and through the building is, and how the kind of creative tension between the old and the new is heightened in a space like that, where they're really not quite crashed into one another, but certainly brought very closely and sharply into juxtaposition. Whereas the rest of the building we treated as carefully and kindly as we possibly could. So stripped the 19 layers of paint off the cedar ceiling, conserved the original natural ventilation that the building had, this very elaborate system of ducts and vents that drew hot air out into roof monitors, which we all made to work again, because an early decision was that we wouldn't air condition these spaces. It would simply be too intrusive. Whereas the modern fittings and lightings are treated in a very contemporary way, but kind of faintly recall the chandeliers that the building might have had once. And this, of course, is the grand ballroom on the first floor, where when we scraped back some of the plasterwork, we found these, it's called sgraffito, where a layer of white plaster was put over a layer of pink plaster, and then that decorative pattern of vines and urns was scratched from the white through into the pink. And we had a team of fabulous Italian men who conserved as much as we possibly could of that and then reapplied the fake marble plaster between it in the original colours of pink and white. And I think one of the really nice things about this building is it had all been kind of vaguely conserved in the 70s in those kind of pus and blood colours that people think are heritage. And yet when we did accurate paint scrapes, it had this really nice, fresh, contemporary pink and white and grey colour scheme throughout. And so we were able to get this sense, I think, of a bit of contemporary vibrancy as well as things like that mad ceiling. Adaptive reuse isn't the kind of only thing we do, and there's a kind of matrix there of some of the other projects we've done, from three or four freeways, the Arboretum that SueAnne mentioned, which was both a landscape and a series of buildings, as well as some more conventional things like apartment buildings. And I think we've got a really intriguing mix of work in the practice. I tend to sum it up being that we get all the jobs that are too hard for everyone else, which tends to mean a lot of work on our part, but it continually, I think, keeps us interested and engaged. And this thread of adaptive reuse that never stops in the office. I've got three of them on at the moment. The Bondi Pavilion that I mentioned, the one with the bird poo radiator, which is the old King School in Parramatta, and another one which is doing up a late 1950s Sydney icon, the roundhouse at the University of New South Wales, which we're kind of treating as a heritage building, even though it is not heritage listed. So that's the end of the